By now, we're all familiar with the word coronavirus. As we make this video, our economies are grinding to a halt and many, many thousands have died, all because of a tiny, tiny, submicroscopic infectious agent called SARS-CoV-2, which doesn't respect borders, treatments, or any of today's vaccines. On March 11, 2020, the World Health Organization declared its outbreak a pandemic, which means it's now spread across the whole world.
COVID-19 can be characterized as a pandemic.
Many world leaders like President Trump in the US or President Rouhani of Iran, sadly, initially downplayed the virus as a conspiracy or just another seasonal flu. But is this novel virus really the same as the seasonal flu? In this Think video, we'll tell you what we know about COVID-2019, how it's transmitted, and how, with science, we can protect our friends, family, and humanity. Like seasonal flu, this new coronavirus is caused by a virus, but unlike the others, this newer, novel strain seems much more dangerous as it's infecting many more people than others. So far, the mortality rate for it has been 2 to 3.5%. While information is still coming in and it might be less than that number eventually, it's definitely much worse than the seasonal flu, which tends to kill 0.1% of patients. But let's back up a bit. We'll start with the word virus. A virus is really small, so small you can't normally see them under a light microscope. Viruses tread this weird line between life and death because they're not technically alive until they enter a host cell, like a human cell. That's when they suddenly become alive and multiply. We call this COVID-19 virus a novel virus because it's new, one that hasn't been seen infecting humans before. We do not have the natural immunity to fight it, nor do we know how to treat it. We know this virus spreads from person to person mostly through droplets that exit the mouth or nose of the infected person when they sneeze, cough, or even just talk and breathe. When you cough, you throw out something like 3,000 droplets others can't even see. They're about 30 times smaller than the width of a human hair. Scientists think these droplets can float in the air for hours and stay on surfaces for days. And unfortunately, you can contract COVID-19 just by touching a contaminated surface, like a doorknob, and then touching your face. One of the biggest problems with this virus has been how hard it is to know if you even have it. Generally, if you've been infected, you might develop a fever, cough, and shortness of breath 2 to 14 days after exposure.
It can make some people a little sick with a slight runny nose. Other people get more sick and can have difficulty breathing and develop pneumonia.
Elderly people, especially those with existing conditions like diabetes or respiratory diseases, are the most vulnerable because as humans age, our lungs and body become much more prone to infection. But experts are now saying that even young people might not be as safe as they initially thought. So far, almost 80% of infected people have shown very mild or no symptoms at all, what scientists call asymptomatic. That's great because who wants symptoms, right? But actually, it's not that great because these people may not realize they have the virus and might infect vulnerable people without anyone knowing. During these panic times, every cough or sneeze doesn't mean you have COVID-19. Here's a useful chart that separates symptoms of allergies, common colds, strep throat, the flu, and of course, COVID-19.
What scares me is getting help if I'm really sick. When do I know it's an emergency?
And this is the important thing to know. So for most people, it's going to be mild. The symptoms are going to be mild. You'll recover. But you do need to understand when it progresses. And those things to look for would be shortness of breath, chest pain, a change in your mental status. You're more confused, more lethargic, bluish coloration to your fingers or your lips. These things should prompt you or someone who's maybe with you to say something is getting worse and you need to seek medical attention.
Even though we still don't know that much about this virus, by March 2020, when this video was released, we knew even less when it first spread in Wuhan, China. When that happened after an initial cover-up by the regional government, the Chinese government locked down the entire province about a month after the first case. Though this was an extreme measure, world experts agree it was necessary to stop an even broader spread of the virus. South Korea has been a model for testing and treating this novel virus. As soon as the cases started to peak, the whole country implemented vigorous testing with 50 drive-through screening clinics, and today its health workers are processing 15,000 tests a day. Places like Hong Kong, Taiwan, and Singapore have also managed to test and quarantine their populations and reduce the spread of the outbreak, for now. On the other hand, in countries like the UK, USA, and Germany, testing has been delayed, and governments have been reluctant to put in stronger measures to stop its spread, often because of politics or a fear of economic impact. As a result, these countries have not properly contained the virus, and many people have been infected. A vaccine could stop this deadly global outbreak. Today, we don't have a vaccine for it yet. Scientists are scrambling to create one, but even at this pace, it might take 12 to 18 months before we get a vaccine. And this 12 to 18 month period is actually insanely fast when it comes to making vaccines normally. But what can we do? We won't be able to completely contain the new virus. It's too late for that. But you might have heard about flattening the curve to minimize impact. With this virus, people get ill so quickly that hospitals might run out of beds, meaning lots of people die without medical care, like the tragedy that's happening in Italy right now. But we can take steps to stop it spreading by what's called social distancing. That is, keeping 1 to 2 meters away from each other and even self-quarantining, staying at home for a few weeks if we feel unwell. You also have heard that boring request to constantly wash your hands with soap for 20 seconds, but we promise, soap is an unlikely hero here. You might think of soap as gentle, but actually it's extremely destructive to viruses. You see, each virus is protected by a layer of oily, fatty lipid molecules, and soap can pull this lipid molecule layer apart. But soap can only do so much. That's why you shouldn't touch your eyes, nose, or mouth, the main passages for this virus into your body, before you properly wash your virus-contaminated hands with soap. By reducing how much of the virus we carry, how much of it we push out in droplets, and how much of it we spread by being near each other, we can flatten the curve of how many people have to be in hospital. For now, that's all we can do until scientists develop longer-lasting vaccines and drugs. Right now, a pandemic is already underway. In the most extreme scenario, half of the Earth's population gets it, our health services get overloaded, and tens of millions of people die this year. Then now that might have been the case in the past, but today we also have better technologies to deal with this pandemic. As time passes, this virus will join the list of other viruses we've survived, like the Spanish influenza, swine flu, SARS, and MERS. But without distancing ourselves following quarantine and washing our hands, we might be hurting ourselves and our loved ones. People will die. People are dying. You have the power through taking these steps and sharing in whatever way you can these methods to your friends and family. This will save lives. We hope at Think that you and your families are safe through these difficult times.